Raise3D just launched its very first SLS 3D printer, the RMS220. Unlike most of its competitors, it packs a powerful 75-watt fiber laser and even includes an integrated nitrogen generator. Features you only see on much more expensive machines. On paper, that could make it one of the most productive SLS systems in its class. But does it really deliver? Let's find out. Hey everyone, welcome back to the 3D Natives Lab. I'm Elliot, and today we're taking a closer look at Raise3D's first step into the world of SLS. Raise3D, founded in 2015 and now celebrating its 10-year anniversary, has built its reputation on FDM and resin systems. But moving into SLS is a completely different challenge, with tougher competition, more complex workflows, and high expectations for productivity and reliability. That's why this review isn't just about another Raise3D machine. It's about finding out whether the RMS220 is truly a serious SLS contender or simply the company's first step into a much more demanding market. The RMS220 was first announced earlier this year at TCT Asia. It's been available for pre-order for a few months, with commercial availability expected in early 2026. For transparency, the unit I'm testing here is a pre-production model that's already 9 months old. By the time the first units ship, it will be nearly a year old, and Raise3D has already confirmed several improvements for the final release. I'll highlight those throughout this review. Here's the plan. We'll start with the hardware and specs, dive into the software and firmware, look at real-world performance and workflow, and finally, see how the RMS220 stacks up in terms of price and positioning. From the outside, the RMS220 strikes a good balance between compact and professional. It occupies just 0.58 square meters, which makes it more approachable for smaller labs and workshops compared to large industrial SLS systems. So you'll still need a controlled environment to run it. I also appreciated the ESD safe casters, which make it relatively easy to move despite its size. At the heart of the printer is a 75-watt fiber laser at 1064 nanometers, paired with a galvanometer scanner and F-setter optics. This configuration allows scanning speeds of up to 30,000 millimeters per second. For context, many competitors sit closer to 12 to 20,000 millimeters per second, and the Formlab Fuse One Plus, for example, uses a 30-watt fiber laser. On paper, the combination of higher power and faster scanning means Raise3D is aiming squarely at productivity. The build volume is 220 by 220 by 350 millimeters, so about 17 liters, and the chamber can be heated up to 220 degrees Celsius. There are important differences between fiber and CO2 lasers. CO2 lasers are more powerful and can handle a broader range of powders, including white powders. But they degrade faster and require significant cooling, sometimes even water chillers. Fiber lasers, by contrast, consume less energy, are more stable over time, and allow the RMS220 to run on a standard 230-volt 16A outlet without special electrical upgrades. This makes installation and everyday operation far more accessible. The RMS220 also uses a hopper and recoater system rather than dual platforms. The hopper stores the powder and the recoater lays down consistent, even layers onto the build platform. The hopper reduces the machine's footprint while the recoater, which Raise3D has patented, ensures smoother powder surfaces and greater consistency in part quality. Since SLS relies on perfectly flat compact layers, this is a critical detail. Another standout feature is the build unit 220. It's detachable, which streamlines workflow by letting you swap units while one cools down or roll a finished unit straight into the cleaning station. Active cooling inside the build unit accelerates cooldown. So in as little as 15 to 30 minutes after a print finishes, you can swap and start the next job. For atmosphere control, the RMS220 includes an integrated nitrogen generator, a rare feature in this price segment. To reach a full 75 watts of laser power, nitrogen is required. You'll need to connect an external air compressor which drives the generator. Raise3D chose nitrogen because it's easier and cheaper to generate than argon, and still effective for this class of machine. You can also print in air mode, but that comes with higher powder refresh rates, which I'll explain later. Finally, usability. The printer has a large touchscreen, LAN and Wi-Fi connectivity, as well as a built-in camera for remote monitoring. On my pre-production unit, key internal components are still mounted with screws, but Raise3D confirms the final model will feature quick release mounts for easier maintenance and cleaning, along with a chamber coating that reduces powder adhesion to the walls. On my test unit, a number of internal and external parts were still 3D printed, rather than injection molded. That's expected at this stage since this is a pre-production machine, but Raise3D confirms that the final commercial version will feature injection molded parts for improved durability and finish. The RMS220 runs on Raise3D's Idea Maker software, and during my testing I was able to try out a better version that already includes the new SLS features. If you've used Idea Maker for FDM or resin, the interface will feel familiar. But here you also get tools specific to powder bed fusion. One key feature is what Raise3D calls 3D packing, essentially nesting, which automatically arranges parts in the build volume to maximize density and efficiency. During my testing, I still found that feature somewhat primitive, as it wouldn't automatically rotate the parts for optimal printing results. That's something Raise3D could hopefully improve before the RMS220 reaches market. Another interesting addition is an analysis tool that highlights potential issues like sudden temperature changes in the build. This helps predict warping risks before you even start printing. On top of that, Idea Maker provides a very detailed breakdown once slicing is complete. You can see weight packing density and even a cost analysis of the job, which is helpful for quoting and planning production runs. On the machine side, the touchscreen is the main control. It's polished visually and features all the functionalities you might expect. The firmware includes automated routines, such as self-calibration of the four IR heating zones to keep the chamber uniform. And the RFID material tracking ensures the right profiles are used for each batch of powder. Raise Cloud support is also in the works. Compatibility with the RMS220 is expected around Q2 2026, which should make remote monitoring and job management easier for teams working across multiple sites. Specs are one thing, but a real question is, how does it actually print? Let's jump into real-world performance. Now, when it comes to materials, the RMS220 ships with Raise3D's own powders, but the machine is not closed. You can either unlock it entirely for about 6,000 euros, which gives you access to all the printing parameters, or you can use material cards. Each card unlocks 10 kilograms of powder for 120 euros. Raise3D is also working closely with third-party suppliers, so you'll see compatible powders on the market that come bundled with these cards at no extra cost. One of the first examples is an FDA-approved polyamide from Fabulous. By the time this video goes live, they should have announced at least 3 or 4 more materials, and they told me that they'll soon add polypropylene, PA6, PACF, and more. So the material ecosystem is expanding pretty quickly. During my own testing, I was only able to print with PA11, as it was the only powder available at that time. I did see some parts made from PA12 and TPU, but I didn't have the chance to print them myself. So my hands-on impressions are specifically based on PA11. I also wasn't able to test the active cooling feature of the build unit 220. On my pre-production unit, the system wasn't fully implemented yet, and I had an earlier version of the build unit, which lacked the external power supply and controls. The final design will not only enable external active cooling, but also let you raise or lower the print platform directly from the unit, making manual cleaning outside the cleaning station easier. As for atmosphere choice, you can run in either air or nitrogen mode. Air mode is simpler but less efficient. Refresh rates can climb up to 50%, meaning you need a lot more virgin powder. In nitrogen mode, refresh rates drop dramatically, as low as 10% with TPU. While the compressor adds complexity, the material savings make it worth it in the long run. For cleaning, Raise3D has designed a dedicated cleaning station, the C220P. It sifts used powder and mixes it with virgin material for recycling. You can either use it closed with the front panel and integrated doors, or open by removing the front panel with the gloves to gain easier access. The built-in ventilation system will catch the airborne powder. Still, cleaning the station thoroughly is tough, which is why Raise3D recommends dedicating one station per material. That might sound costly, but it's common practice in SLS to avoid cross-contamination. On the pre-production unit I tested, the cleaning station didn't yet include an air gun, but Raise3D confirmed that the commercial version will include one, making depowdering even faster and more convenient. Raise3D is also developing a blast cabinet for automated depowdering, scheduled for release shortly after the RMS220 in the first half of 2026. Clearly, they're not just selling a printer, but trying to build a complete workflow ecosystem. Finally, Raise3D recommends starting with a calibration part to fine-tune shrinkage or expansion factors. It's a small extra step, but it really improves accuracy across different materials. So, where does the RMS220 fit? For studios or small production workshops looking for SLS capabilities without the budget or space for larger industrial systems, it's a compelling option. You get a respectable build volume, high laser power, solid material flexibility, and a workflow ecosystem that makes SLS more manageable. It won't suit everyone. If you need ultra-high throughput or very large parts, you'll still need more industrial systems. And as always with SLS, consumable costs and post-processing labor are not trivial. But as Raise3D's first SLS machine, the RMS220 is a very strong debut. And it's not just about the printer. Raise3D is also developing a blast cabinet for automated depowdering, scheduled for release shortly after the RMS220 in the first half of 2026. Clearly, they're aiming to offer a complete workflow ecosystem, not just a standalone machine. Coming in at a price of around €26,999, excluding VAT in Europe for the standard package including the printer, a build unit, the cleaning station and 1-year warranty, the RMS220 is a strong contender in the entry-level SLS 3D printing market. Based on our testing and the final features promised by Raise3D on the units that will ship to consumers, we gave the RMS220 a final score of 9.7 out of 10. At the end of the day, the RMS220 balances power, compactness, and workflow integration better than most of its competitors in this price range. To learn more about our testing of Raise3D's first SLS 3D printer, check out our written article on 3dnatives.com. Thanks for tuning in to this review. Let us know in the comments what you think about Raise3D venturing in the world of SLS 3D printing. And see you soon in the 3D Natives Lab. By then, happy printing!